Hey guys, today I want to take you on a journey. It's a journey about my mouth and your mouth. I've had a problem with my mouth my entire life. Back when I was younger in school, I think every teacher I ever had on every report card I ever brought home wrote a note like, Vince is a good student, but talks too much. Or, I enjoy having Vince in class, except for his constant interruptions due to his out of turn talking. Or, Vince is a pleasure, except he needs to learn to control his talking. Or, could you just please get your kid to shut up? It got so bad, and I would always insist that the teachers were wrong. I didn't really talk that much. That my father would give a tape recorder to my teachers, and she would tape the entire class so I could bring home the tape to prove that I wasn't really talking. It didn't change when I got into high school. The problems just continued. I had this one teacher, a history teacher named Mr. Conklin, and one day, it was like a Tuesday, he threw me out of class and talked and sent me to the principal. The next day, we got our test back, a graded test back, and he went through all the answers of the test to show us what we got wrong and why we got it wrong. And one of the questions was, who is Al Smith? Well, Al Smith was the first Catholic guy to ever run for president. And on my test, I wrote the first Catholic to run. So I raised my hand and said, Mr. Conklin, you marked mine wrong, but it's actually correct. He said, well, what did you put? I said, he's the first Catholic to run. Mr. Conklin said, the first Catholic to run. And I said, what do you think, the Boston Marathon? Threw me out of class. So the next day I walked into class and I said, so Mr. Conklin, how long is it gonna take you to throw me out today? Can we do three in a row? And he said, get out of here, you're out. Sent me the principal 3 days in a row. I've had a problem with talking with my mouth my entire life. All that is kind of funny, but as I grew up, it became much less so, less funny, because I continued to cause problems with my mouth, but it wasn't so much talking too much anymore, it was more the things I said that came out of my mouth, and I hurt people with my words, pretty much everybody, but eventually the person who I ended up hurting the most was the person I spent the most time with. My wife. She would say something, and I would say something like, "And that's really stupid," or, "What a stupid thing to say." And then she would say, "Don't call me stupid," and I'd be like, "I didn't call you stupid. I said what you said was stupid," but it didn't really matter because. Even if I was right, I was wrong. Because in her mind, I had called her stupid. And I remember back when we were dating, we would have these huge fights. I mean, just all the time. I remember one of them. We were in a mall, and we got into some huge fight. I don't remember what it was about. I'm sure it was something I said. And she kind of just took off. And she's like, I don't need to deal with this. And walked away from me, and I was like, fine. And I walked the other way. But it wasn't fine because I had driven. It was my car. I had the keys to the car. And this was a time before cell phones. And so it was like, we separated. It was like, how is she going to get back to her apartment? Because I need to drop her off. And I mean, is she going to walk? And how do we find each other? And the funny thing is, I don't even remember what the fight was about, but I'm sure it was something I said. on our honeymoon. We got in this huge fight. Again, I don't know what about, but I remember that it lasted like an entire day, kind of killed an entire day of our 3-day honeymoon. And I don't even remember what it was about, but I'm sure it was something I said. Our 1-year anniversary, we lived out just outside of Washington, D.C. We had very little money, but we wanted to do something for our anniversary. So the only thing we could afford was we drove 4 hours to Virginia Beach, Virginia, and got the cheapest hotel room we could find. And we were able to spend, you know, the later part of the first day and the morning of the next day at the beach for our vacation. And we got in a huge fight, and it ruined the vacation. And I don't remember what the fight was about, but I'm sure it was something that I said. And I have had problems with my mouth my entire life. You know, our mouths do a lot of talking. People love to talk. Do you know that the average American has 30 conversations a day? And experts tell us that we spend about 1/5 of our entire lives talking. In 1 year, your words would fill up about 66 books, each 800 pages long. So in 1 year, you'll talk more than an entire Bible. They say that men speak on average about 20,000 words a day. Women speak about 30,000 words a day. People love to talk. We love to talk. Like on TV, what do we have? Talk shows. On radio, more talk shows. Sports, man, experts debate you know, the topics of the day on roundtable discussions, and fans call into radio talk shows to voice their opinions. Politics, forget about it. We love to talk. And often what we're saying, the words coming out of our mouth, is the wrong thing. I've had problems with my mouth my entire life. Probably most of us have had problems with our mouths, with our tongues, with our words, our entire lives. And it may surprise you to find this. The Bible actually talks quite a bit about what we talk about. The Bible has a lot to say about our mouths. And one of the key passages in the Bible about our mouths, about our tongues, about what we say, is found in the Bible book called James. And a couple weeks ago, we started this brand new series called Objects in Mirror Are Closer Than They Appear. And it's all kind of going through passages in this book of James. And so today, we're going to look at another passage, and we're going to find out what the Bible says about our mouths, about our tongues. So let's start with James chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. Not many of you should presume to be teachers, my brothers, because you know that we who teach will be judged more strictly. We all stumble in many ways. If anyone is never at fault in what he says, he is a perfect man, able to keep his whole body in check. So first, James offers a warning. He says, if you teach, and he's talking about teaching within the context of church, not like a public school, but he says, if you teach and you teach the wrong things, you use your mouth to teach the wrong things about God, man, that can have major consequences. And so he says, teachers are going to be judged more strictly. Then he goes on, he says, man, we all stumble in many ways. And probably the easiest part of your body to trip over is your tongue. Why is that? Well, let's look at James chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. When we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we can turn the whole animal. Or take ships as an example. Although they are so large and are driven by strong winds, they are steered by a very small rudder wherever the pilot wants to go. The idea is that you can take a 3,000-pound horse and put a little 90-pound jockey on it, and that little jockey can control the horse with just a small bit in its mouth. That's crazy, but it's true. And the same is true for us. Just a little bit can control our lives. And just a small word or a small phrase can change the entire direction of our lives, you know? And it's kind of like we shape our words, but really words shape us. I'm outside of a tattoo shop. And you know, when you get a tattoo, it tattoos your skin. But the reality is that words can tattoo, you know, our hearts, our spirits, our identities. Some of you were shaped by the words of another person. They just got tattooed on you. Maybe it was a person who said words like, you're stupid, or you're a loser. Why can't you be more like your brother? You're not going anywhere in life. And eventually what happens, when those words get tattooed on us, we end up repeating those words, sometimes to ourselves. I'm not. I can't. I never will be. I'll never be good enough. My father, when I was a kid, he tattooed words on me. Words that ended up shaping me. Words like dumb, worthless, stupid. And those words wounded me. They shaped me. And to some degree, they have determined the course of my life. Now, the obvious irony is that I hated those words, but I ended up becoming a person who used some of those same words with other people. We also need to be careful with our words, because our words can shape others. Not only do the words of other people shape us, but our words can shape other people. And that's why we need to be really careful with our words, because just as the words of other people have shaped us, our words can shape other people. This is also why we need to make it a real priority to read and know God's word, because we can be shaped by God's words instead of the words of other people. And I'll tell you, when you let God's word shape you, man, your life is changed, because words really do shape us. And when we allow God's word to shape us, it changes us, because we start to embrace our true identity. Words from the Bible like, I am more than a conqueror. And you replace I'm a victim with I am more than a conqueror, it changes you. I am an overcomer. I have the mind of Christ. I am a child of God. I am filled with the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead. Do you see the difference that it can make when you allow your life, your identity to be shaped and tattooed by the words of God rather than the words of another person? I'll tell you this. My life was directed and shaped and tattooed by the words of my father. And I reached this point in life where I believed in Jesus. I knew that he really was the Son of God, really died for me. And so that changed my eternity. But my life, my everyday life, wasn't really changed until I started to understand and accept and embrace God's words about my life. But when I started to realize, I'm not my father's kid, I'm a child of God. And I am valuable. Jesus died for me. And I started to have my identity shaped and tattooed by God's words. And that's when my life changed. And we all need to do that, because words shape us. Words can get us in trouble because our tongues direct where we go. And so we need to be so careful about the words that we speak and the words that we embrace. Our words can also get us in trouble because, man, my tongue can destroy what I have. Likewise, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boasts. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small spark. The tongue also is a fire, a world of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole person, sets the whole course of his life on fire, and is itself set on fire by hell. James continues by writing, think how much can be destroyed by a fire that starts with just a small spark. In 1983, a fire was set in Australia by just a small spark, and that fire ended up destroying over 600 miles of land. In the same way, he says the tongue, it's just a spark, but it can create a fire that can do serious damage. And our tongues can get us into really big trouble. Sometimes it's because we talk too big. You know, we boast, we overpromise, we make promises that we could never really keep, or we simply make promises that we don't even intend to keep. Did you know that according to the Bible, when you make a vow, when you make a promise, you're actually making a covenant with God? It's not just that you're promising this other person something, but you're making a covenant with God that you're gonna keep your word. But many of us, man, we make promises like they're nothing. We break our promises like they're nothing. And that's scary, because our promises are a covenant we've made, not just with the other person, but with God. So we boast, we make big promises. Now, our words also get us into trouble, because our words can destroy relationships, right? And too many people use their mouth to tear other people down. They may do that by speaking ugly words to them, or by speaking ugly words behind their backs. And our tongues destroy relationships. Tongues can also destroy churches. Every once in a while on the news, you might hear about like an arsonist who set fire to a church and burned the church down. But I'll tell you this, the fastest way to destroy a church is with your mouth, by people spreading rumors, gossip. Words can also offend God. I actually think that biblically speaking, the worst thing that you can do with your mouth is to use God's name in vain. God in the Bible is very clear. Like you read the Ten Commandments, he says, don't use my name in vain. Do you know what it means to use God's name in vain? It doesn't necessarily mean to use it as a curse word. The word vain means nothing. Like if maybe sometime you said, man, I did all that work in vain. What it means is I did all that work for nothing. And so what God says is, don't use my name like it's nothing. My name is holy, it's important, it's precious. And so don't use my name like it's something that's not special, because it is. So examples of this would be when we say things like, oh God, or oh my God. And you know, a lot of us do that. Now, my guess is that if you do that, you don't intend to offend God. You're not meaning to use his name in vain. You're not meaning to, you know, break a commandment. It's just, that's just what you've always heard people do. It's maybe what you've always grown up doing. So maybe you never knew, but you know now. And listen, we really don't want to use our words, our mouths, to offend God, the God who loves us and gave his life for us. Our tongues get us into all kinds of trouble. And listen, we're going to be held responsible for that, for our words. Jesus warned us about this. Let's look at what he says in the book of Matthew, chapter 12, verses 36 and 37. I tell you that men will have to give account on the day of judgment for every careless word they have spoken. For by your words you'll be acquitted, and by your words you'll be condemned. Jesus says, we're going to live with the consequences of the words that we've said. Our tongues, and they can get us in big trouble. So what should we do? What do we do about it? Well, let's look at the rest of the passage in James chapter 3, and we'll see what direction we get. Verses 7 through 12. All kinds of animals, birds, reptiles, and creatures of the sea are being tamed and have been tamed by man. But no man can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil full of deadly poison. With the tongue, we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse men who have been made in God's likeness. Out of the same mouth come praise and cursing. My brothers, this should not be. Can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? My brothers, can a fig tree bear olives or a grapevine bear figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water. Says we can tame animals, and that's true, right? I mean, just think of all the animals we've trained. Lassie, Shamu, Trigger, Flipper, you remember Clyde the orangutan or Mr. Ed? You know, people can train animals, but in our family, we can't even get our dog to stop eating poop. Anyway, we can tame animals, but then it says, but no man can tame the tongue. No one can tame their tongue. Only God can. You can't tame your tongue. Only God can. And it talks about how it just doesn't make sense to speak out of both sides of our mouths, you know? And it gives examples like probably the highest use of your mouth is to praise God with your words. And what some of us do is we'll come here to a service and we'll do that. We'll show up here and we'll sing songs of praise to God, but then we'll leave here and critique the service or curse at our families. And this passage is saying, man, that just doesn't make any sense. And it just further reveals how we can't tame our tongues. Or think of how we put people down. This passage says it doesn't make sense to put people down because people are made in God's image. And it's just wrong. I can hardly speak. I understand why you can't raise your voice to say. Why does all this stuff come out of our mouths? Jesus actually told us in the book of Luke, chapter 6, verse 45, he said, out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. Out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. Our tongue problem reflects a heart problem. And that's the point James is making in this passage. It's like whatever's in the well comes out in the water, but whatever's in the tree comes out in the fruit, and whatever's in the heart comes out of your mouth. The problem we have isn't a tongue problem, it's a heart problem. You know, a lot of times we say something and then we'll be like, oh, I didn't mean what I said, right? In courts, it's called the Adele defense. Just cause I said it, don't mean that I meant it. You know, and we say that, right? Like, well, just cause I said it didn't mean I meant it. That's not like me to say something like that. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Our words come out of our hearts. And man, you show me someone with a harsh tongue, I'll show you someone with an angry heart. You show me someone with a negative tongue, I'll show you someone with a fearful heart. Show me someone with an overactive tongue, I'll show you someone with an unsettled heart. Show me someone with a boasting tongue, I'll show you someone with an insecure heart. Show me someone with a filthy tongue, I'll show you someone with an impure heart. Show me someone with a critical tongue, I'll show you someone with a bitter heart. So again, the question we have to ask is, well, what's the solution? Well, we've already learned from James that we cannot tame our tongues. We can't. Only God can. And the problem is a heart problem. So the answer, the solution, check this. We need a new heart. And God can give us a new heart. I'm in front of a hospital, and back in 1967, the first heart transplant surgery ever took place. It's incredible if you think about it. This person had a heart in them that didn't work right, and it was removed, and a new heart, a different heart was put in that person. Amazing. It's incredible. But God has been doing that kind of surgery for a long time. He's been giving people new hearts in a spiritual sense. In fact, in the Old Testament, God tells us in Ezekiel chapter 18, verse 31, it says, rid yourself of all your offenses that you've committed and get a new heart and a new spirit. The answer is to get a new heart. And that happens when we truly hand our lives over to God and invite Jesus into our lives. What God does is he does this supernatural heart transplant surgery where he gives us a new heart. And you know what? It's been really cool hearing a lot of you, because you talk about the fact that you've experienced this. Now, I have people all the time at Verve saying things like, "Vince, I don't understand what's happened to me. But since I said yes to Jesus, I've just changed so much. It's weird. I mean, I care about different things now. I react different to stuff that happens. I think about different things. I relate to other people different. I'm just so different. I don't get what's happened." I do. You have a different heart. God came into your life when you invite him into your life, and he gave you a new heart. And listen, it's that new heart that gives us the ability to have a new mouth, to have a new tongue, to stop saying some of the things we've always said, and to start saying some things that we always should have said. Now, listen, once we get this heart transplant surgery, once we get this new heart, then we need to guard our new hearts. Have you ever gotten a car, maybe a new car, at least it was new to you, and man, it was perfect and it was pristine, and then like 2 weeks later, it's filled with dirt and dust, there's like old French fries on the floorboards, right? Listen, God comes in and he gives you a new heart, a pure heart, a heart for him, but then we need to guard our new hearts. We need to make sure they don't fall into, you know, bad condition and disrepair. This is what the Bible teaches us in Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23. It says, "Above all else, guard your hearts, for it is the wellspring of life." That's huge. Proverbs 4:23 says, "Above all else, guard your heart, for it is the wellspring of life." And so you need to guard your new heart. If I gave you an assignment for the next month, guard your heart, what would that lead you to do? Are there some things you wouldn't look at? Or maybe some places you wouldn't go? Some things you wouldn't do? Maybe some things you wouldn't say? Some things maybe that you wouldn't allow yourself to think about, or to think about yourself? Is there anybody that you wouldn't be able to hang out with? But whatever it is that you would do, listen, God has given you that assignment. He says, guard your heart above all else. Guard your heart. Do whatever it takes, because out of your heart flows your life. And out of the overflow of your heart, your mouth speaks. So we need to get a new heart, and we need to guard our new hearts. And we also need to guard our mouths with God's help. The Bible says in Psalm 141, verse 3, it says, "Set a guard over my mouth, O Lord. Keep watch over the door of my lips." See, you can't control your tongue, but with God's help, you can guard your mouth.
Choice, even if you cannot hear my voice, I'll be right beside you, dear.